used to hear in my grandparents' home. And when I wrote about that universe, I feel that in a way I was dignifying those words and that particular experience. And I wrote about, well, that's an advice they give you when you start writing, write about what you know. And I just did that, you know, because I wrote on my first and only novel published so far, I just finished the second one, I wrote about this neighborhood. I invented a neighborhood that was inspired in my real neighborhood. And the thing is that for a common Portuguese reader, that world that I depicted on my novel was a kind of foreign to them. It's not just saying that it could be exotic or strange to other European readers, but even for Portuguese readers, they felt like a different world, because usually it's not the kind of world you see depicted on novels, on Portuguese novels. That is a neighborhood, a poor neighborhood. Its inhabitants came from Africa and from the slums around Lisbon. This neighborhood is in the outskirts of Lisbon. So people are not used to see this kind of setting on Portuguese literature. So I think talking about kind of sociological terms, it was important in that sense. Of course, I didn't meant to make a manifest, sociological or anthropological manifest. I wanted to write a book about people I knew and some I invented, but I felt that they belong also in that world. But I think that was one of the reasons that people relate to the book, because it was a different setting. But I do believe that it might be different, but there's something universal. I think that was Tolstoy that said, write about your village and be universal, and you'll be universal. So I tried to do that.
Wonderful. Nia, you're based in Wales, which is, you know, its language identity is one of its sort of key issues in Wales just now. And so there is a bilingualism, and UK is also a multilingual country in that sense. So in that milieu, how has your work shaped up?
Well, I write poetry in English, but I'm from a Welsh family that used Welsh as their writing language. But by the time I grew up, my grasp of Welsh is very bad because I grew up in England. But I live in Wales now, and I'm very influenced and interested in this bilingual culture, which is sometimes a conflict and sometimes a great inspiration. Welsh is spoken by about 25% of the population of Wales, but its poetry tradition and writing tradition is extremely strong. In fact, one of the biggest selling magazines of poetry in the UK is Bardas, which is the Welsh language poetry magazine. So, and it's a very old tradition of writing. But I also, I'm very interested in how my writing kind of slip between these different cultures, and I'm very interested in translation, although my actual grasp of these languages is not very good. You know, I grew up in England, so I've kind of been stripped of that possibility. The most recent project that I've done is called The Long Words, or actually its full title is Czechoslovakia Lalishtarabin Misiniz, which is a Turkish word which means, are you one of those whom we couldn't make to be originating from Czechoslovakia, which is a tongue twister in Turkish, which was the inspiration of this book, which each of the titles of the poems are English translations of very long words in various different languages. So I use those as prompts or spurs to sort of write these poems which explore the idea of miscommunication or mistranslation, because some of these titles sound very strange in English and don't really work, it made me think about how poetry, whether poetry is communication and what is the core, because I'm also a feminist writer, also interested in decolonization, and so I also write essays, and that's my other side of my work. I hope that's okay.
Wonderful. David, since, I mean, you work with national book institutions to help them bring their literatures across the world, how much does really market determine how European literature travels into other parts of the world?
Right. Well, the market is the primary determinant of what is read in other countries. So in the context of Europe, there is a lot of traffic between the major languages, so French, German, Spanish, Italian, even Dutch, and English, of course. And then there is this other sort of smaller languages, if you will, some of which hail from the same countries of these big languages. So France has small languages that perhaps few people in the audience have heard about. Spain has five other languages, at least officially recognized, and they don't even travel well in their own country. Publishers, and that's when the authors sort of become part of the national canon. So in a way, it's not even an international, you know, problem. It's a national problem. It's within us, and you know, even our mental maps, when you speak the predominant language in a country, sometimes, you know, tend to think of the writers from the other, that write in the other languages as a sort of peripheral, when in reality, you know, they might be very central to their own landscape and to their own languages.
And I'd like to just get Alexandra in on this. She has so many years, I mean, nearly 30 years of experience as a cultural manager, organizing events, and she's a translator herself of many anthologies, translating primarily from the Czech language into English. Alexandra, how does translation enable this movement? I mean, market, of course, is, as David says, is one determinant. But does translation of literatures, especially in the context of Europe, has that helped European literature travel better because they have been translated? Have they been translated enough, in your opinion?
Before we started, we were instructed by one of these gentlemen sitting over there that we should state our country and before we start talking. And I'd like to actually follow that instruction. I was born in Prague, and I've lived in several countries, and for the past almost 30 years I have lived in Britain. And I'm an Australian citizen, so, you know, I'm really, in many ways, a citizen of the world. I'm a translator, as Venuta said, but for the past 15 years I have been heading an organization called Literature Across Frontiers, and our main aim is to, and our motto is making literature travel. We're trying to encourage more translation, and of course translation, you asked, you know, does translation help? Yes, translation is at the center of literature's traveling. We can't really have literatures moving across borders and from country to country without translation. So what it is that is needed to actually make this happen, we need translators, and translators, it sounds like, you know, a commonplace, but translators are the ones who, as you would confirm, Maria and all the others, translators are the ones who are really the ambassadors of a literature they are taking across linguistic frontiers. We also need interest on the part of readers, we need interest on the part of publishers, And it's a great pleasure to be here in Kerala, where I know that it is a state of readers. It is a state of which encourages love of literature, love of books. And every time I talk to someone from here, and I ask them what are readers in Kerala interested in, I'm always told, literary works, something that's really serious. And I think that's very encouraging. So I hope that eventually we will be able to introduce more authors from Europe. This is really our aim, to promote European writing, and especially to promote new interesting voices like those of Maria's and Bruno's and Mia's. Against the background of what you already know, what you have been already reading, the classics.
There is a lot of contemporary European literature that may not even reach India, and I don't know why that there, I mean, because in a, even a state like Kerala has read so much of European literature, but up to a point in history, and it hasn't really moved since then. So, David, why do you think that is?
Thank you. One should give reverence to authors and their works when reverence is due, but what should not mystify certain generations of authors either. And I think sometimes we get hung into certain generations of writers, the boom generation, magic realism, the classic Russian authors. That sort of, it's very good that we still accord importance to these seminal writings, but sometimes it sort of prevents a conversation or an approach to new writing. I think there's one particular issue that perhaps creates this lack of ability that you had before with all those generations that we were talking about. So it really demands more attention from the reader, more sort of interest in exploring and getting out of, the canon, so to speak. I think, it was clear in the past that there was a canon, and you cannot talk about canons anymore.
Exactly. Because we were earlier discussing, Maria, about how there are Europe's within, I mean, there are many Europe's, there's no one Europe. I'd like you to comment on that a little.
Yeah, I have to say that also as a translation scholar, I beg to differ a bit with what David says, because I think that there are so many issues that have to do with power and language that many times we do not realize that David gave the example of those of us who do not write in Spanish within Spain, and how we are expected to be translated into Spanish before we can travel. And I think this is the same for writers here in Malayalam or Tamil or Hindi, that they are expected to be translated into English, and then from English they travel. So of course these English translations can be needed many times because we do not have translators from different languages. We may need a language in between, which does not have to be English also. But I think that we have to consider that many times maybe the readers of Malayalam may be more interested in something written in Czech or in Lithuanian or in whatever the language, Galician or Catalan. But we are forced to go through these main languages, and that's a hindrance, because if I speak about this relationship that we have with Tamil Nadu, it's clear that there is an interest between writers from Galicia and writers from Tamil Nadu in this case, not only because of the language but also because of this decentering of our identity as Westerners and having to face our others. And this is something that for me it becomes a trap, having the goal of this important language, be it English or Spanish or whatever it be, as an end in itself. So I think that institutions such as Literature Across Frontiers or others who are trying to establish a more diverse relationship are necessary everywhere, because I always say we need to talk to each other. Those of us who are seen as margins from the center, have to start thinking that we are centers of our own worlds, and we need to talk to each other from our own centers. So many times when we get translations of, say, literature from India through English, there are many things that do not get translated, but which could interest Galician readers, for example, or readers in other languages in Europe, but not necessarily readers in English. So I think that we need to start questioning also these ideas of power, and, you know, we need to discuss that in more detail. And I think that if we share something in Europe and in India are the issues of multilingualism. So we need to start talking about all the languages and not just, you know, have as a target translation into English or Spanish or French, because there are wonderful writers, as you know very well, in languages that are not those.
Nia, in your experience, I mean, how mainstream do you think you are among your peers? Sorry, the mics.
Hi. Well, I edit a magazine that is seen as international and British. So in that case, I have got a position within mainstream literature in the UK. It gives me a certain amount of power. but the way I write, it maybe is a little bit non-mainstream in the kind of processes that I use. Also, I'm very interested in poets and writers from other European and other parts of the world in translation, which actually in the UK, generally, most writers, most of my peers look to Anglo writing, particularly from North America, although I'm also very interested in North America. So in that case, I'm slightly apart from them. But of course, I'm not the only one. I shouldn't give the impression that I'm a lone pioneer. And also because I'm publishing lots of different styles and forms, I'm interested in how other art forms intersect with poetry. I'm interested in performance and visual art as well. So in that case, I'm probably in some ways like my peers. So, yeah.
Bruno, because, I mean, there is some element of diasporic writing in the themes that you've chosen for your first book. Does diaspora have a presence? I mean, there are many diasporas in Portugal, but then there's also the central kind of Portuguese identity, right? I mean, because Portugal was a colony. So you have diasporas living in Lisbon, say from Goa. There's a huge diaspora there, and they have their own versions of stories. Is there some sort of commonality in these experiences?
Well, I don't really think so, because it is not well known, this kind of writing. I was talking to a Brazilian scholar the other day that is leading this project about literature written in Portuguese from Goa, and it is almost forgotten, that literature. Well, he said to me that it was a kind of a conservative Catholic literature, that literary was not that good, but it is important for those kind of projects are important. But I would say that we don't know really, that we don't share this this feeling of belonging to the same literary world. Of course, there are writers that are influenced, Portuguese writers that are influenced by Brazilian writers, but or African writers. But I don't think there's this mixing. I think that, for instance, Brazil is a huge country, and nowadays is really the motor of Portuguese language. But they really don't care too much about contemporary Portuguese literature. Of course, they read the classics. They read the big names, and I think that's one of the problems, not only in the relationship between Portugal and Brazil and Africa, but with other countries as well. Yesterday, I found here in the bookshop books from José Saramago, Antonio Lobo Antunes, Mário de Carvalho. These are big names in Portugal. And I think that the European writers can, well, identify them and have read some of their works, especially, of course, Saramago, that was awarded the Nobel Prize. And I was glad to find them here. At the same time, I think that if you only focus on the big names, you don't get to know the reality of a literature. It's like, being with an elite from a country, you're thinking that's representative of the country. Of course, well, there's always big names. But it's like to think that Moby Dick is alone in the sea. There is all these small fishes, and people don't know them. Sometimes, even within our countries and the countries where the same language is spoken. So I think we must, not only within countries, but within Europe, trying to make literature travel, not only through the big names, the classics, but also with contemporary writers that are writing. Sometimes I read Portuguese, contemporary Portuguese writers, that they have a lot more to do with other European writers than with the Portuguese writers. And we have some that are published in Central European countries or so, and they are successful there. Because right now we don't have those aesthetic groups or like we did in the past with neorealism and the existentialism that were very popular. And now I think each writer is writing on his own, his or her own.
There's no literary movement in that.
No, I don't think so. I think people right now, it's a kind of pick and choose their influences. And sometimes, that's what I'm trying to say, there are writers, Portuguese writers, that have a lot in common with writers from other countries, because they share the same cultural references, and they don't have anything to do with ancient Portuguese writers or so. So I think if people across Europe read these authors, they will find very close to them, but we need to make them travel.
And sort of taking that point up, I'd like to ask Alexandra, because you've curated so many exchanges between poets and writers across Europe. What are the challenges that exist for organizations like Literature Across Frontiers to make this happen?
Well, there are many, and we have now a major challenge we are facing. We are based in Britain, we're based in Wales, and I have always been very proud of the fact that we have been managing this big European project from a country which is really on the edges of Europe. And at the same time, it's a country with, as Nia pointed out, with a very, very long literary tradition. What we're facing now is the reality of Brexit, the reality of the fact that a relatively small percentage of people in Britain voted to turn the country's back on Europe. And I think this is a very, very sad moment in our history. It also means for us that we are facing the possibility of losing our funding from Europe. And I think the biggest challenge is to face this isolationism on the part of a section of British population. I would say this is really what, you know, what preoccupies us at the moment. At the same time, what's rewarding about the work we are doing is precisely these moments, sitting here on this stage, facing an audience that's really interested in what we're doing, and talking, having writers from different countries discussing and, you know, being in dialogue.
I'd just like to briefly touch upon the issue of multilingualism, which India has in common with Europe, except that in India it is a nation of languages and in Europe it's a continent of languages. So the language policies are individually managed, whereas here we don't have that same flexibility. But there are many similarities too, because some of our writers travel across languages only after they win the Sahitya Academy Prize, or you know, and that's pretty much the standard. But there are more prizes in Europe that help identify contemporary writers. I think there are many more such opportunities for writers to be identified by publishers. Is that, am I sort of, or they're not enough?
Well, there are different channels through which writing travels, and we always talk about the gatekeepers. Nia is one of them. We are a gatekeeper. We have started selecting 10 of the most interesting young writers from Europe. We've just selected the second year of this. We have a second year of this project now, and I think it's these kind of multiple selections, multiple lists that come from different directions different perspectives that actually provide a kind of kaleidoscope of European writing, because indeed, if you wait to hear about European writings through translations into English, you won't really find that much, because it is a language which has been very resistant to translation. So I think we need these multiple relationships, multilateral relationships, and this is really how our organization started. I remember how I was looking at how kind of cultural relations were working, you know, 20 years ago or 15 years ago, and they were very bilateral. You know, the British Council was promoting British culture here in India, and Cervantes Institute was promoting Spanish writing and so on. And I thought, this is not how it should be. You know, we need this multilateralism. We need these institutions to cooperate together to promote European writing in its diversity, rather than compete against each other. So this was the kind of ideal of, you know, it was a vision with which we wanted to really overcome this kind of bilateral attitudes. At the same time, you can have a relationship like the one that Maria described between a small country, again on the edges of Europe, and part of India. And I think really, if this becomes part of the mosaic, where Maria is sitting here talking about this in, you know, this discussion, then I think we have achieved something.
I'd like to ask the writers quickly about how these exchanges help you in your work going forward, being part of a network that is created by an organization like Literature Across Frontiers, where you get to interact with writers from other parts of Europe. How do you think this would help you?
For me, as I said, as a writer writing in a non-hegemonic language, this is like life to us, because we find so many barriers in our own states that when we have the chance to be in a space where the state is not in between, I'm speaking particularly about the case of Galicia, which is of course not applicable to other parts of Europe. That's the way in which we can talk about our work, we can interact with other writers, and people can know what we do and what we write without having to go through the centers of power that are predetermined, and that many times have no interest whatsoever in what we do. Because, for example, in Spain, there are many Spanish language publishing houses who refuse to even consider translations from Galician, Catalan, or Basque, because in their minds they think that if you have something important to write, you write it in Spanish. So if we have to fight that fight every time we want to speak about our work, it makes our life very hard. So when we are in these spaces
with writers from different languages and different cultures, we feel, or I feel at least, very free. And yeah, that's the summary of it.
Bruno, how do you think this experience of being identified as one of the creative writers of Europe with a bunch of other writers, how would this work for you going forward?
Well, I would say that in being with other countries, other languages, maybe small languages, we become aware that well, there is much more to literature than sometimes we think, and I think it's good also for readers, this kind of events, to so they can be aware also of this kind of writing. Because one thing that is happening for I would say the last decade is that there are few European writers that only get translated into other European countries after being successful in the United States. And the United States is a country that doesn't translate that much books, to say the least. So it's a kind of paradox that you have writers. I would give this example, there's the now that is translated everywhere and is being successful everywhere, the Italian writer Elena Ferrante. She was published, I think, 12 years ago, a small book in Portugal, and it went unnoticed. Nobody cared. And after being successful in the United States, where everybody is talking about her books are bestsellers. So I think that this kind of projects really try to go around that. We don't have to read what the U.S. Critics or U.S. Market wants you to read, because it doesn't make sense. It doesn't make sense that a country that translates so few works of literary fiction tells you what to read, what European writers should read. So I think it's one of the good things of this kind of projects, is that writers and publishers and journalists become aware of different realities. It's not all about Knausgaard and Ferrante and Roberto Bolaño. There's a world that's beyond the U.S. market.
True, I agree. We also face this because many of our English writers come to us through the U.K. or, I mean, nowadays through the U.S. Mia, you write in English, so it's, you know, your readership is already that much, I mean, technically speaking, in a language. So do you look forward to sort of, through these exchanges, also make your work aware in other languages, as a curiosity?
Interacting with other languages and other cultures through literature is absolutely like essential to the way that I work as a writer and the way that I think. That's why Brexit is such a so depressing and so so catastrophic, really, because it makes British culture even more isolated, or even more kind of mired in its own false sense of greatness than we previously were. So I've always been interested in other cultures, and I actually think a lot of my fellow writers in Britain, even though they are often also really only working within English, a lot of the time not aware of other literatures. I mean, you just mentioned Bolaño and Ferrante, and actually many people in Britain, they haven't even read them. So, so despite that, I still think that my peers, my other writers in Britain, would also immensely benefit from the enriching powers of interaction across cultures in India, in Europe, everywhere. So more work like Literature Across Frontiers and organisations like it would be very welcome.
Thank you. I'd like to open up the panel discussion to the floor for interaction. If anyone has any questions, please raise your hand so I can see it. And if you could identify whom you'd like to ask the question to, that would help.
It is the time for interaction with the audience.
Hello. Yeah, my question is to Alexandra. So, yeah, at this current scenario, you can see that during this digital age, the people's reliance on books has actually reduced. So, if you take Indian scenario, number of people who are reading books has considerably reduced. And if I can say, a lot of libraries have been shut down here. So, how is Europe scenario in this? And how is people's reliance on the books there?
The question is about readership, and that book readership is coming down in India, and one of the signifiers of that is that libraries are shutting down. So how is it in Europe in terms of, you know, is readership growing? And that is the question.
Thank you for the question. It is a serious problem. I think the problem with libraries being shut down is one issue, and that has to do with decisions made about, budgetary decisions made by local governments and so on, and it's something that we really have to oppose. At the same time, I think there's a problem with literary culture, with books actually competing increasingly with other forms of circulating ideas, and of course social media is one big culprit. People, and especially young people, increasingly learn and find out about the world through social media rather than through books. So, where does that leave us? I don't think I have an answer, and it is something that we see in Europe as well. As here in India. One thing about social media is that, again, it is a channel through which we can promote books and we can promote reading. So I would say, that's something we have to consider.
Thank you. Sorry. Bruno, what one gathers from your, is this, if not, please correct? Every literary ecosystem. Yes, of course. But whose question is this, please? Okay.
So, it says here, Bruno, what one gathers from your messy accent? So I'll answer to this. The other day I was in Goa speaking with readers, and I said, well, I'm tired of apologizing for my broken English. I think that it's really a matter of praise and not apologizing. We European writers, and I've been into some festivals and literary events with other European writers, and some of them try so hard to make themselves understood in English. English is not my mother language, so I won't be apologizing and I won't answer you.
I'm appalled by this question. I actually, this afternoon, I complimented Bruno on his English. I think if we judge people by their accent, then we first have to look at ourselves. I think, received English, Queen's English, is no longer something that anybody appreciates. I think each and everyone on this panel has been very eloquent and has, contributed to the discussion, has contributed with very interesting ideas. I don't know where this came from, and really shame on you.
Any other questions from the floor, please? Yeah.
My question again is to Bruno, because I know Portuguese literature is really very vibrant. I was expecting what are the new trends in your literature, because as we know, postmodernism has almost unlamented death it is, you know, because they would like to know what are the new trends in Europe literature.
You would like to know what are the new trends in European literature, which we didn't cover in our discussion. All right. Is there someone specific you'd like to first? Bruno?
Well, again, I will speak about Portuguese literature. That's one that I know best. There are these writers that are more influenced by Central European writers for mid 20th century that really don't have anything to do with the Portuguese literary tradition. And so I think that's one of the main trends with the new names that are publishing right now. But as I said before, I think that the most dominant feature is that the literary scene in Portugal, and I think it is also happening in other European countries, that literary scenes became atomized. So each writer is collecting its own set of influences. There are writers in Portugal that are more akin to American writers, short story writers such as Raymond Carver. Others are connected to magical realism from Latin America. And others, as I said, are connected with Central European literature. That is a literature that a few years ago it was not well known in Portugal. So it's, I think it's a new trend. I really don't know that much of other European literatures besides the big names to make any considerations about them.
I would also like to add that in Britain, I think what's happening is that many writers are becoming increasingly political in what they're writing and how they're trying to respond to current crises in Britain, but also across the world, and also maybe trying to respond to this what is questionably called post-truth politics by trying to actually grapple with the confusion and chaos of our kind of current moment. I think quite a lot of writers and poets and artists are trying to kind of respond to that, some more than others, some more successfully than others. But I think that's also a big trend where I'm looking from.
Maria?
In our case, I think that the situation might be a bit different. I'm not sure that we can be speaking about new trends, but the issue of identity and problematizing our identity has always been there in our literature. But maybe now it's a more complex form of problematizing identity. As people who are pushed or defined as peripheries, we have always been aware that there are literatures, other literatures out there, and the Galician language is very keen on translation despite all the financial difficulties that we have found. But in that sense, I think it's a literature that's nowadays very permeable to influences from other writers, as I was saying, from Tamil Nadu, but also from other parts of Europe, and very diverse, and it tends to both, as Bruno was saying also about Portugal, look towards its past and rewrite its past, but also try to have a more contemporary approach to what we are and who we are within the, you know, European cultural landscape as a nation, I would say, that's not that doesn't have a state, a stateless nation. But that comes in all sorts of forms. This is just like a basic idea behind it. And I think that maybe in novels, we can see that the settings of the novels have changed a lot. If we look at the beginning of the 20th century, most novels were set in Galicia. That was the space where everything happened. Nowadays, it's not necessarily like that. If I look at my own novels, some of them have characters that are not Galician per se, or that have mixed roots and identities. And that is not something particular of my own writing. It's also present there. But as I said, it's difficult to define trends because it's a though people think that it's a small literary system, it's quite diverse when you look at it from the inside.
I think in one of the things that David had mentioned, he did talk about how there aren't any specific things, because people are writing about so many different things that you can't really spot where there's a movement, which even Bruno had commented upon earlier.
Right. Well, we should be clear that one thing is to speak of, you know, commercial labels, as, you know, with the Nordic Noir. And a totally different thing is to identify something that is organic, some trend that is organic. So again, when I was referring as the market, is normally, you know, the big concerns, the big publishers, the commercial line of the business, and those are the ones that are very interested in you know, pointing at something that they construe. It has to be said that Nordic Noir is an artificial creation. You know, crime novels have been written in the Nordic countries forever, and suddenly, you know, a few group of authors struck a chord in the UK. And again, we go back to this issue of why certain countries and are sort of fixing in the collective consciousness these so-called trends. So yes, coming back to this question of whether there are trends, one can say that you know, it's we are perhaps in most countries in Europe getting out of you know, certain themes, certain topics that have perhaps been exhausted. In the case of Spain, for many years we had this almost infatuation with our civil war and you know, all the post-war history. And that sort of became a slippery slope because, you know, in the beginning it was really necessary to memorialize, especially, you know, the stories that were not covered by the official version of history. But then in the end it became a sort of, you know, writing, you know, romance novels, historical novels, even sci-fi novels about the Civil War. And then it almost became a parody. And you can also speak about, you know, in Poland, how the Holocaust has been, you know, a trunk thing for many years, and how now authors are, you know, abhorred about, you know, keeping that topic on. So they are resisting the demands of some publishers who are the ones that are wanting to keep those topics alive.
Right. I was told we have a last question. You can give us 3-4 minutes more, sir. Oh, there is another session after this. Okay. I'm so sorry. I believe there was a last question which we couldn't take, but the writers are here for some more time. So if you'd like to catch them and speak to them one-on-one, you must do that. Thank you all for being a very receptive audience here today. And I'm sorry for the question that was addressed to Bruno. It's something that I was taken aback by myself. Nonetheless, it was, I think, a very interesting discussion for us, and the important thing to know about Europe is something that I also realized today. When I speak about India outside, I always say India is not one country, it's so many you know, literatures within India. But I'd made that same assumption about Europe today, and Maria had corrected me that Europe is not one entity. There are many differences within different regions and within each country too. There are other languages that we don't know about and that we should be reading more of. So I hope that the gatekeepers in publishing will start working harder to bring some of these voices to India as well. Thank you all. Good night.